So this is a presentation on the imaging in cellar and suprasellar lesions. I will begin with embryology, followed by normal anatomy, a few anatomical variants, and then we will talk about cellar and suprasellar masses, including solid as well as cystic lesions. This is by no means a comprehensive overview, but more of a case-based review of a few interesting cases, which will help us to see that the problems we may face in day-to-day reporting. So, starting with embryology, the pituitary gland lies in the cella. It has two parts, the anterior pituitary or the adenohypophysis and the posterior pituitary. Both these parts of the pituitary gland arise from the ectoderm, but they have different origins. The adenohypophysis is formed from the rat-case pouch, which is a superior invagination from the primitive oral cavity. This is ectodermal, obviously. And the posterior pituitary arises from the neuroectoderm, as you can see. So, the anterior pituitary wraps around the optic chiasm and the neurohypophysis comes from the neuroectoderm. This pituitary gland lies in the cella. Here we see the cella, which is a bony concave cavity. Anteriorly, here we see the tuberculum cellae. Posteriorly, we see the dorsum cellae. The cella is very closely related to the sphenoid sinus. So, any abnormality in the sphenoid sinus, for example, sinusitis or in mucocele in the sphenoid sinus, should be reported in our reporting of the cellar pathologies. This is the pituitary gland. Here we see the adenohypophysis, which has a superiorly concave border normally. Then we note the height of the adenohypophysis. The height may be increased in physiological conditions like puberty or pregnancy or immediate postpartum period. Posterior to the adenohypophysis, we see a hyperintensity even on non-contrast even weighted sequences. This hyperintensity is the posterior pituitary bright spot. Superior to the adenohypophysis, we see the infundibulum. At the top of the infundibulum is the tuber cinereum. Here we see the optic chiasm. Superior to the optic chiasm is the chiasmatic recess and the lamina terminalis of the corpus callosum. In the infundibulum is the infundibular recess. Superiorly we see the region of the mammillary body, the hypothalamus, which lies in relation to the mammillary body, and the interpedicular system posteriorly to the cella. Posteriorly, the cella is also related to the clivus. Alright, so first we will talk about the cella. The size of the cella, any enlargement or erosion, is typically seen on CT. Previously, it used to be seen on X-rays, but now very few of us actually see hardly any X-rays of the skull are being done. So, on the sagittal X-ray of the skull, we can see, and on the sagittal tomogram of the CT also, we can see the cella and we can note the size, whether it is small or whether it is enlarged and is there any erosion in the cella. Nowadays, with multiplanar CT being available, with multiple slices, 128, 256 slice CTs being available, for that matter, even with a 16 slice CT, we can reformat the axial CT images. We can take thin sections and reformat it into sagittal to see the size of the cella, as I will be showing in one of the cases. Okay, so the cella, this is the normal size of the cella. Please note it down for future reference. The cella can be small as a congenital variant, or it can be seen, small cella can be seen in dystrophia myotonica, or if the patient has received radiotherapy previously. Enlarged cella can be seen in patients with, for example, normal variant like double cellar floor, or if there is destruction of the anterior clinoid process, or if there is any erosion of the cella itself. The cella may be enlarged in patients with cellar masses or in patients who are having raised intracranial pressure. For example, any other intracranial mass or long-standing intracranial mass can lead to raised ICP, or even idiopathic intracranial hypertension may lead to slight enlargement of the cella. The normal height of the adenohypophysis is typically measured on the coronal images. Here we are seeing the superiorly concave border of the adenohypophysis, which is a normal variant. The Elster's rule is very well known. In infants and children, the height should not be more than 6 millimeters. In men and postmenopausal women, it should be 8 millimeters. In women, it is slightly larger, up to 10 millimeters. And in late pregnancy and in the immediate postpartum period, it may be still further enlarged physiologically. That can be up to 12 millimeters in height. Here we have a 7-year-old girl with early puberty and hypercorticism. MRI was performed to rule out any cellar mass. So here we saw the superior convex border of the adenohypophysis, and the height was increased. For a 7-year-old, the height should not be more than 6 millimeters, but the height here measured 8 millimeters. And it was unchanged over the next, on a follow-up scan. It was suspected to be a pituitary adenoma, but this is actually just a pituitary hyperplasia. Another variant that is seen is the hyperintensity of the adenohypophysis in neonates. Here is a 5-day-old infant which shows hyperintensity even on the non-contrast sequence in the adenohypophysis as well as the posterior pituitary bright spot. And this hyperintensity in the adenohypophysis resolves over time. This is a normal 4-month-old pituitary adenohypophysis which shows the normal signal like the rest of the brain parenchyma. And the posterior pituitary bright spot is still seen. So how do we approach the differential diagnosis? First, we identify the cella and the pituitary, both the adenohypophysis and the anterior pituitary bright spot. So this is the cella and the adenohypophysis. Then we determine the epicenter of the lesion. Is it in, above, below or lateral to the pituitary? And whether the lesion is solid, cystic or mixed solid cystic, heterogeneous? Is there any calcification? Are there any flow voids in the lesion? So here we have the pituitary gland, and the lesions are predominantly in the cella or in the pituitary gland. Then the differentials of pituitary adenoma or Rathke's cleft cyst or craniopharyngioma may be considered. These are lesions which are centered in the cella. Lesions may be centered in the supracellular region or maybe involving the pituitary stalk. These lesions are typically germinomas, eosinophilic granulomas, metastasis, lymphomas, etc. Superior to the infundibulum, we see the optic chiasm. On the coronal images, it looks like a figure of 8 appearance which is laying on its side. So this is the optic chiasm, and we see that the signal intensity of the optic chiasm is just like that of the normal white matter. If the optic chiasm is hyper intense or bulky, then the differentials of demyelination or glioma should be considered. Or if the lesion is centered in the region of the optic chiasm or in the supracellular cistern, then these differentials should be considered. Superior to the optic chiasm, we will see the region of the hypothalamus. Lesions involving the hypothalamus are the opticochiasmatic or the hypothalamic gliomas, hamartomas, germinomas, eosinophilic granulomas, etc. Lateral to the cella, we see the paracellar region. In the paracellar region, we see the cavernous sinuses and we see the flow void of the cavernous ICA. As we note in this patient, for example, the left cavernous ICA flow void is very much enlarged as compared with the right cavernous ICA. So the differentials of aneurysm, ectasia of the ICA or keratoco-cavernous fistula should be considered in this setting. So just to recap again, if we are having cellar supracellar masses, they can be like typical masses itself, which are microadenomas, macroadenomas, meningiomas, craniopharyngiomas, or invasion by any skull-based tumors or metastasis. These are the most commonly seen cellar masses, cellar supracellar masses. Any mass-like lesion in the pituitary may also be non-neoplastic. For example, pituitary hyperplasia, apoplexy, pituitary abscess, aneurysms, Rathke's cleft cyst, or infundibular non-neoplastic thickening by eosinophilic granuloma, LCH, or sarcoidosis. Okay, so this is just a quick recap. Okay, so patient comes for evaluation for pituitary microadenoma. Typically, the clinical profile will read as amenorrhea or galactorrhea. And often we'll see in the history that we have been provided only one line, elevated prolactin. But we don't know how much it has been elevated. Is it just like 30, 40, 50 or is it very high? So sometimes prolactin may be mildly elevated, slightly elevated, and this can be because of involvement of the stalk or medications. But if the prolactin is elevated more than 200, then we have to strongly suspect a microadenoma and look for a microadenoma. Sometimes in 20 to 30% of the patients who undergo dedicated imaging of the pituitary lesion, we may see incidentalomas, incidental microadenomas in the adenohypophysis. So when we are imaging for a microadenoma, we have to look for any asymmetry in the gland, if there is any slight bulkiness or bumpiness on one side, if there is any shift in the stalk. For example, if we are suspecting a microadenoma on the right side, the shift should be towards the left side, should be on the contralateral side because of slight mass effect. We have to also evaluate carefully the dynamic post-contrast sequence, which is a very important sequence when we are evaluating for a pituitary microadenoma. So why is this dynamic sequence so important? The pituitary gland does not have a blood-brain barrier like the rest of the brain. So if we inject contrast, the pituitary gland will enhance brilliantly. So any small tumor in it, like a microadenoma, which is less than 1 centimeter in height, may be missed on routine delayed post-contrast scan. But in the early phase of the enhancement, while the pituitary gland will enhance brilliantly immediately, the adenoma will take some time to enhance and will tend to enhance later in time than the normal pituitary parenchyma. Hence, we may be able to pick up the delayed enhancing adenoma on the dynamic imaging much better than the delayed post-contrast scan, when the entire gland including the adenoma will enhance uniformly. Hence, dynamic post-contrast sequence, which is typically a spinico sequence, is performed in all patients in whom microadenoma is performed. Just to note, this dynamic sequence is not required if we are having a very large, obviously bulky cellar, suprasellar mass, and we want to see, is it an adenoma, is it a craniopharyngioma, is it LCH, or is it something else? We don't need to do this dynamic sequence for any other lesions. Only if we are suspecting a pituitary mass and the scan looks relatively normal and we want to rule out a microadenoma, which will not be seen on other sequences, then we do this spinico sequence. Contrast is injected in a rapid bolus, preferably using a pressure injector if available, and then multiple sequences are acquired to get this time intensity curve. So we are seeing this multiple acquisitions. This is the pre-contrast sequence, and as contrast is injected, we see how contrast initially enhances the infundibulum and the central part of the gland, and then the contrast enhancement spreads to the peripheral part of the gland as time passes. Alright, so I will show the same thing in a video. Great. So it played, we can see the enhancement of the pituitary gland on the delayed sequence. Okay, I replayed it. Just to note, the resolution of this sequence is good. This is a very thin sequence, but the signal to noise ratio may not be good. So this is very good for looking for some small microadenomas that are missed on the routine post-contrast sequences. We can hardly make it out. Now that we know that it is there on the dynamic sequence, we can see some differential enhancement on this. Otherwise, we would have very easily missed it on the routine T1 coronal images. The signal to noise ratio is much better on the routine T1 coronal images, but resolution is same on both these sequences. We need thin sequences evaluation of the pituitary, whether it is for a micro or a macroadenoma, 2 or 3 millimeter thick sequences. So this same microadenoma, again I have shown on the dynamic sequence that this enhancement is seen, and I have marked out the size also, so around 4 millimeters in diameter. And it is hardly seen on the T2 weighted sequence. Here we have another patient, a 27-year-old female with a tiny microadenoma on the left side of the adenohypophysis. Then we have a 51-year-old lady with a headache. Here we see that the cella is mildly enlarged and the adenohypophysis is bulky, measuring more than 1 centimeter in height. So this is a macroadenoma, and for this patient we really don't need the dynamic sequence. The mass is well seen. Anything that is more than 1 centimeter in height, for a post-menopausal woman, anything more than 8 millimeters in height will be classified as a microadenoma. This lesion is just abutting the optic chiasm. Here we have another patient with a large homogeneous lesion with post-contrast enhancement and widening of the cella seen on the CT. And on MRI, again we can see the snowman or the figure of 8 appearance of the cella. There is not much involvement of the paracellar regions. The lesion is not extending into the cavernous sinuses, nor is it encasing the ICA more than 180 degrees on the left side. On the right side, there is some invasion into the cavernous sinus, and we can see almost 270 degrees involvement of the cavernous ICA. So this suggests that there is extension into the paracellar region. All these findings are important when the surgeon is planning to operate this patient. Also, we note that the cella is enlarged and the lesion is extending towards the sphenoid sinus. So maybe even transsphenoidal approach may be used for this for the surgery of this patient. When we are reporting this cellar supracellar lesions, especially macroadenomas, which are probably going to be treated by surgery, diffusion sequence and DTI sequence plays a very important role, because in the DTI sequence, we will see the anisotropy of the lesion, and this will show how hard the lesion actually is and how easy it will be. Is it suckable, cusable, and surgery, or will it be a large, hard, unyielding lesion that will be very difficult to remove on surgery? So this is the role of diffusion tensor imaging in patients with macroadenomas. Here we have another patient, a 43-year-old with a sudden onset headache and decreased vision. So we see a cellar supracellar mass which is hyperintense on T2 weighted images, and note that even on T1 weighted images it is mildly hyperintense. On flare also it is hyperintense, and we can see a slight fluid level on T2 weighted and flare images. I hope you can appreciate it. So this is a patient with a macroadenoma with pituitary apoplexy. Here we have another patient, a 7-year-old girl who presented with precocious puberty and primary hypothyroidism. Her TSH was elevated, it was 156, so that's very high. Patient had precocious puberty with thalarchy and menarche, and she had short stature. When we did imaging of the cella of the pituitary gland, we saw that the pituitary gland was grossly enlarged and showed intense homogeneous enhancement. Initially, we thought it was a pituitary macroadenoma. On follow-up scan with treatment, TSH normalized. We can see TSH came back to 15, and the pituitary gland also reduced in size with medical management. So this was not a macroadenoma. A macroadenoma will not resolve with treatment of the hypothyroidism. And so this patient actually had just a pituitary hyperplasia and not a macroadenoma. And this condition with juvenile hypothyroidism, with isosexual precocious puberty, also delayed bone age, this patient had delayed bone age and high TSH and multicystic ovaries, is known as Wernicke-Grumbach syndrome. So any patient with hypothyroidism and precocious puberty, we should not think of a macroadenoma. These patients can have pituitary hyperplasia, which will resolve with treatment. This is Wernicke-Grumbach syndrome. This patient also had multicystic ovaries. We can see the multiple cysts in the ovaries and bulky ovaries. Here we have another pediatric patient, another pediatric case. 2-month-old child with failure to thrive and hyperbilirubinemia. We can see how yellow the kid is. Images are used with permission of the patient. Bera showed severe hearing loss. Here we are seeing that the cochlea are grossly enlarged in size and with cystic dilatation. The pituitary gland is also hypoplastic. The adenohypophysis is very small. Hypoplasia of the anterior pituitary, which is well seen on the blown up images. So this was basically, this patient is having jaundice, this typical faces with a hook-like nose, failure to thrive. Also, there was pancreatic lipomatosis, hypoplastic adenohypophysis and enlarged cochlea. So this is another esoteric syndrome, Johnson-Blizzard syndrome. No radiology presentation is complete without a couple of these esoteric syndromes. So I couldn't resist putting these cases, but they are very rare. So that's all right, just for clinical interest. All right, coming back to the more commonly seen pathologies. So here we have a patient with a T2 hypointense and a T1 hypointense lesion between the adenohypophysis and the posterior pituitary, not enhancing. So this is a Ratzke cyst. This is a typical Ratzke cyst. So we should distinguish a Ratzke cyst from a cystic adenoma. If the patient is having any endocrine dysfunction like increased prolactin levels or hypercortisolism, or off midline location, we'll think of a cystic adenoma. Ratzke cleft cysts are typically in the midline and hypointense on T2 weighted images. These are characteristic features of a Ratzke cleft cyst or a pars intermedia cyst. Often they can have T2 hypointensity with T1 hyperintensity. On T2 sequence, if the cyst is slightly big, we can see an intracystic nodule. Honestly, I have never noticed this intracystic T2 hypointense nodule. And during that case, cysts may also vary in size without treatment. So that's the interesting part. Coming back to paracellular extension of the pituitary tumors. So here we have a patient with a macroadenoma. We are seeing it is abutting the optic chiasm. So this is what needs to be reported. And also the cavernous ICA is encased by more than 270 degrees. Here it is encased by around 180 degrees. So on the right side, there is no cavernous extension. But on the left side, there is extension into the cavernous sinus. So there is paracellular extension. And there is almost complete encasement of the cavernous ICA. Point to be noted, the flow void of the cavernous ICA is maintained. It is not compressed. And for example, had it been a paracavernous meningioma or any other paracavernous lymphoma or any other paracavernous mass, the ICA flow void would also have reduced in size because of the mass effect. But typically, because pituitary tumors or pituitary macroadenomas are not very, very hard lesions, they will encase the pituitary, but the flow void will be well maintained. Another sign is the tentorial enhancement of the pituitary. Here we can see there is some slight enhancement of the tentorium, which is a sign of cavernous sinus involvement, very well seen on the actual images. Another differential is a supracellular cavernous ICA or a supraclinoid ICA aneurysm, which can be mistaken for an adenoma. On MRI, it is very difficult. I mean, we can see that this is a flow void. Obviously, this is an aneurysm. But especially a non-contrast CT, when the flow void is looking slightly hyperdense, it can be missed out on a non-contrast CT. So always, always, always rule out an aneurysm. If we miss this diagnosis, if we miss a supracellular aneurysm and report it as an adenoma, it will be a disaster. Okay. So from the mass lesion, they are going towards empty cellar syndrome. Cella is mildly enlarged, but there is hardly any pituitary parenchyma seen. Okay. Coming to supracellular non-pituitary masses. Macroadenomas are very common, but if we are seeing a pituitary gland adenohypophysis, which is separate from the supracellular tumor, then this is not a macroadenoma, this is something else. Now, what is it? We will see the differentials. Always, 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 if it is not a macroadenoma, we will see the differential enhancement of the adenohypophysis or some slight differential signal on T2-weighted sequences. So here we see a supracellular cystic lesion which is hyperintense on T1 weighted images and which shows slight blooming on gradient sequence. This is a 65-year-old lady with headache and loss of vision. So we are seeing a supracellular cystic lesion with T1 hyperintensity. This is a craniopharyngioma. Craniopharyngioma can also show multiple tiny cysts with heterogeneous enhancement. And we can see calcification, tiny specks of calcification in the cella supracellular region. Craniopharyngiomas may sometimes be associated with other pathologies. Here we had a patient in Sri Chitra. This is a patient with Rathke's cleft cyst who also had an associated craniopharyngioma. And we can see this fluid level very well on the sagittal images. Coming back to the case we saw previously, this is a child with an adenohypophysis seen separately from the supracellular heterogeneous solid cystic lesion. What is this? Is it a craniopharyngioma? No. This is an opticochiasmatic glioma. Another patient with an opticochiasmatic glioma in which we show that the optic chiasm is enhancing with a paracellular solid cystic mass lesion. So this is another opticochiasmatic glioma. Another patient with a supracellular lesion with blooming, extensive blooming on gradient sequence. So is it calcium? Is it blood? It is hyperintense on T1 weighted images also. This is actually a supracellular mass with hemorrhage within. This patient is a pyelomyxoid astrocytoma with BRAF mutation positive. Another supracellular mass is a hypothalamic hamartoma apart from a hypothalamic and opticochiasmatic glioma. Okay, here is a quiz question. A 55-year-old patient came with headache. We did a CT. CT was normal except for enlargement of the cella. This enlargement of the cella was well seen on the coronal reformatted image. Enlargement and slight erosion of the cella. So we performed an MRI which shows this mass. So is it a macroadenoma? This was thought to be a macroadenoma, but no. Here we see that the adenohypophysis is enhancing separately from this mass. And the slight differential signal intensity is also seen on the T2 sagittal images. Here again we see that the adenohypophysis is enhancing it differentially from this mass on post-contrast images. So this was not an adenoma. this was actually a meningioma, a cellular meningioma. This patient was biopsied through the transsphenoid approach. Here is another supracellular meningioma. The adenohypophysis is separate and we are seeing the supracellular meningioma with a classic dural tail. Another patient on CT, fat intensity with calcification, supracellular lesion, fat intensity with calcification. This is a supracellular dermoid. And we know that this is, on pre-contrast images itself, we are seeing it is hyper-intense. And we are seeing hyper-intensities along the sulci. This gives us a clue that this dermoid is actually ruptured. And other tiny supracellular fat intensity is seen on the coronal non-contrast T1 weighted images. So this could be a lipoma or a tiny dermoid. CSF intensity supracellular lesion is a supracellular arachnoid cyst, which shows no enhancement. What about this lesion? Supracellular and paracellular lesion. This is Rosai-Dorfman disease. Okay, coming to children with short stature. Typically, children with short stature come for imaging. We will see ectopic posterior pituitary. The posterior pituitary should actually lie behind the adenohypophysis. So here we see that the posterior pituitary is ectopic and the anterior pituitary is also hypoplastic. Other findings that we can see in these patients can be septo-optic dysplasia or corpus callosal agenesis or single central incisor. Then we have another patient with short stature. We see the anterior pituitary is hypoplastic but posterior pituitary is in correct location. Then we have a patient with hypogonadotropic hypogonadism in which the olfactory bulbs are not visualized. This is Kallmann syndrome. Here we have a patient with a single central incisor well seen on the axial images. The anterior pituitary is small with a tiny cyst within. The clivus is also hypoplastic. This is a spectrum of imaging findings that we may see in patients with short stature. Here we have another patient with short stature. Adenohypophysis is hypoplastic. And we also see that the right optic tract is not myelinated as compared with the left optic tract, which is well myelinated, which is well seen on the DTI images also. There is differential intensity of the both the optic tracts. The right optic tract and radiation is different in signal intensity. Here we have a patient with diabetes, insipidus, posterior pituitary, bright spot may not be seen, or they can show intense enhancement of the infundibulum in patients with hypophysitis. This is an interesting paper from KEM Hospital in the pituitary journal on the different imaging spectrum of hypophysitis. On T2 weighted images, we can see T2 hypointense signal in the periphery in autoimmune hypophysitis. Here we have another patient with LCH, Langerhans cell histiocytosis, with a child with signal abnormality in the cerebellum. The pituitary gland looked fine, but there was slight thickening of the infundibulum. It measured 4 millimeters in size. It should not be more than 3 millimeters. Other differentials apart from the supracellular masses are non-neoplastic pathologies like abscesses, infective etiologies, and other tumors like unusual tumors like granular cell tumor. To conclude, this pituitary masses are quite commonly seen. We have to localize the lesion. Is it in the cella or is it paracellular, supracellular? What is the center of the lesion? And then describe the lesion, which will give us a good differential diagnosis. Clinical profile plays a very important role. Dynamic sequence, especially for patients with microadenoma, will play an important role. And if you have to remember only one thing, remember this. If you can see the adenohypophysis, it is not a pituitary adenoma. It is some other lesion.